Nudged Audiobooks presents The Midnight Peacock by Katherine Woodfine, narrated by Jessica Preddy. Part 1. The Mystery of the Haunted Mansion.
"Who goes there? Show yourself!"
declaimed Montgomery Baxter, the courageous boy detective. Chapter 1. Tilly knew quite well that there were no such things as ghosts. She said so, very plainly, much to the annoyance of Lizzie Hughes, who had come rushing into the servants' hall, eager to pour out her tall tale. Some people would do anything to get out of a spot of dusting, Tilly thought. "The East Wing's not haunted," she said, from where she was sitting at the table, finishing off a bit of mending. "That's just a load of all nonsense." Lizzie turned on her at once, hands on hips, nose in the air.
"That's all very well for you to say. You weren't there. I'll have you know I heard it myself, with me own ears."
Sarah and Ella, the scullery maids, were both staring at Lizzie.
"What was it?"
Ella asked. Lizzie lowered her voice to an important whisper.
"The sound of the ghost's footsteps," she announced.
"Ooh,"
they exclaimed together.
"What did they sound like?" gasped Sarah.
Her eyes were as big and round as the plates in her ladyship's best dinner service.
"Loud and echoing and coming closer and closer by the minute. Then the most terrible chill swept over me. It was as if my blood froze. I dropped my duster and ran away as fast as my legs could carry me."
Lizzie collapsed into a chair, as though the very memory of it would make her swoon.
"It didn't half make me feel peculiar," she finished up.
Tilly rolled her eyes.
"You didn't actually see this ghost at all then?" she demanded. "I was hardly going to go looking for it, was I?" exclaimed Lizzie indignantly. "Who knows what might happen to me? So how can you be so sure that what you heard was a ghost? There's bound to be a completely ordinary explanation," said Tilly. "Maybe it was mice." "It couldn't possibly have been mice. No mouse could have made a sound like that." "Well then, it was probably one of the underfootmen playing a trick. I'll bet it was Charlie. He thought it was a great lark to put salt in William's tea last week, remember? Pretending to be a ghost to give you a fright is just the sort of stupid thing he'd do."
But Lizzie shook her head.
"It couldn't have been a trick. That terrible chill, why, I've never felt anything like it in my life."
The other two looked awestruck, but Tilly just snorted.
"It's December, Lizzie. It's cold, and the East Wing is freezing. I think that probably explains your terrible chill."
Lizzie turned her back on Tilly and addressed her next remarks to Ella and Sarah.
"I suppose you've heard the old story about the ghost that walks at night in the East Wing?" "No, do tell us," Ella urged.
In a low voice, Lizzie began.
"Hundreds of years ago, the old lord who lived here at Winter Hall had a daughter that he loved like no other. She was good and sweet and as beautiful as the day. But then, on her 16th birthday, she fell ill and died. The old lord went mad with grief. He locked himself up in the East Wing and never came out again."
She paused and then went on.
"When they finally managed to break through the doors, they found that he was dead as a doornail. And ever since then, his ghost has walked up and down the long passage of the East Wing. If ever a young girl is to go alone to the East Wing at night, the ghost will lure her to her death as a vengeance for his own lost daughter."
She finished up with a flourish.
"Oh, heavens! I shall never dare set foot in the East Wing again," exclaimed Sarah. "There's no ghost in the East Wing," interrupted Tilly. You ought to know better than to believe that sort of codswallop.
Lizzie turned on her.
Well, Tilly Black, if you're so clever, then why don't you go into the East Wing and see for yourself?
She stared at Tilly crossly for a moment and then added,
Right now, on your own. Go on, I dare ya. Or are you too afraid?
Sarah and Ella exchanged wide-eyed glances.
She doesn't really mean it, said Ella after a moment. It's so late and dark. No one would blame you if you didn't fancy it, not after what Lizzie just told us.
What Lizzie just told you is a pack of nonsense, said Tilly, getting to her feet.
She was going to nip this in the bud at once. Otherwise, Sarah would probably keep her awake half the night having nightmares.
I'm not in the least bit afraid to go to the East Wing, she declared. I can tell you for certain that I won't find any ghosts there. But perhaps, if you're lucky, Lizzie, I'll be able to finish that dusting you're in such a hurry to avoid.
With that, Tilly walked swiftly out of the servants' hall and into the passageway. Sarah came running after her. She had only been at Winter Hall for 2 months, and she still looked very small and unsure in her starched white apron and cap.
Tilly! She burst out. You aren't really going to the East Wing, are you?
I've said I will, and so I will, said Tilly crisply.
But, you can't!
Exclaimed Sarah, hastening to keep up with Tilly's longer strides.
There really is something funny about the East Wing, honestly, there is. Old Mary told me she'd heard noises there late at night, and Jamie, the gardener's boy, said that he'd seen lights floating round high up in the windows. Even Mrs. Dawes thinks there's something queer about it. I heard her saying so to Mr. Stokes.
This was quite a long speech for Sarah. Tilly stopped and contemplated her for a moment.
They're just rumours, she said, more gently.
The East Wing isn't haunted. There are no such things as ghosts, Sarah.
She added in a sharper tone.
And don't start hanging about with the gardener's boy. Mrs. Dawes won't like it.
But how can you be sure that there are no things as ghosts? Sarah persisted.
Because it isn't scientific, explained Tilly,
striding off again.
There isn't a single spot of proof that ghosts exist, you know. I read a book all about it. All the scientists agree. Ghosts are just made up.
Well, you should at least let me come with you,
spoke up Sarah bravely as she scuttled along beside her.
You can't go there all alone.
Of course I can, said Tilly. I've been in the East Wing at night alone dozens of times, and nothing terrible has happened to me before, has it?
She didn't wait for an answer, but went on.
Anyway, you should get back to the servants' hall, or Ma will be wondering where you've got to. I'll be back in no time. Promise.
At that, Sarah nodded reluctantly and disappeared back towards the servants' hall. Tilly grinned to herself. She knew Sarah wouldn't want to risk trouble with Ma, who was cook at Winter Hall and ruled all the kitchen and scullery maids with a rod of iron. Of course, Ma wasn't really Tilly's mother. She'd worked that out for herself before she was 5 years old. It was plain as day to anyone with half a brain that they couldn't possibly be related. Ma was small, round and rosy, with fairish hair that was always pinned back smoothly into a neat knot under her cap. Tilly, on the other hand, was tall and rather bony, with a lot of curly black hair that was a struggle to twist into anything even halfway resembling a neat knot. Her eyes were dark brown, her eyebrows were black and bushy, and her skin was brown too.
It wasn't just that she didn't look like Ma. She stood out like a sore thumb amongst the other maids, with their blonde hair and pink and white complexions.
Tilly's real mother had been a lady's maid in this very house. She'd died here, giving birth to Tilly, 14 years ago. No one seemed to have any idea who Tilly's father was. Ma said he was probably just some common good-for-nothing who had turned her poor mother's head,
God rest her soul.
And let that be a lesson to you, she would say to Tilly,
although Tilly was never quite sure what the lesson was supposed to be. But it didn't really matter to Tilly that she didn't have a father. After all, Ma and the other servants at Winterhall had been all the family she had ever needed. She'd been helping Ma in the kitchen since before she could walk properly, and now that she was almost 15, she was a proper housemaid with a frilly white apron for when she served tea in the drawing room. She felt quite grown up, certainly far too grown up to pay any heed to Lizzie's nonsense about things that go bump in the night. Now, she pushed open the green baize door that separated the servants' quarters from the main part of the house. From here, she could hear the familiar sounds of the family and their guests in the dining room. The clinking of glasses, the rumble of conversation, her ladyship's tinkling laughter. The big hallway looked exactly as it always did, with the enormous grandfather clock ticking, and the faces of generations of Fitzgeralds gazing down upon her from the oil paintings that hung on the walls. Tilly couldn't recall a time when she didn't know every inch of Winter Hall, from the cobwebby wine cellars down below to the attic bedrooms up on the rooftops. She knew each creaking floorboard and each of the old leather-bound books in the library. When she had been very small, she had even given names to every one of the stuffed foxes and birds in his lordship's study. Now she was different, taller, almost grown up, but nothing at Winter Hall had changed a bit. In spite of the recently installed electric lights and the wonderful new motor car, everything always felt exactly the same. Once, she had loved that sense of comforting familiarity. It had meant home. But lately, the sameness of Winter Hall had begun to get on her nerves. Tilly longed for something new and different, but her days just kept on going like clockwork. The gong sounding for luncheon, tea served promptly at 4:30, her ladyship scolding her maid as she dressed for dinner, and below stairs, the maid's ironing and the footmen polishing the silver and his lordship's valet brushing his shoes. Even the story of the supposedly haunted East Wing was an old tale that she'd heard 6 times before. Just the same, as she went down the corridor, Tilly suddenly wished she had let Sarah come with her after all. It wasn't that she was scared. Of course she wasn't. She wasn't an idiot. But this part of the house did feel rather dark and lonely. The East Wing was the oldest part of Winter Hall. Once in a blue moon, her ladyship would bring some visitors to look around. They would exclaim in delight over the antique furniture, the beautiful carved chimney piece, the canopied bed upon which it was said Queen Elizabeth herself had slept. But most of the time, the family didn't come here, preferring to keep to the plush comfort of the more modern West Wing with its electric light and running hot and cold water. The only one who was really interested in the East Wing was the youngest Fitzgerald daughter, Miss Leo. Tilly knew she sometimes spent hours here, looking at the pictures or making drawings of the old curiosities she's found. Now, Tilly pushed open the door to the East Wing. It did not creak exactly. Mrs. Dawes was far too particular for that. Instead, it made a strange little sighing sound, rather like someone letting out a breath. The dark passageway yawned ahead of her. As she stepped over the threshold, the flame of a candle gutted in a breath of air, and for a moment, she thought it would go out. She could hear all the little noises of the house settling, a window rattling and the wind howling outside, whirling about the house like a wild creature trying to get in. It sounded ghostly enough, and in spite of herself, Tilly shivered. But immediately, she reminded herself that there was nothing to shiver about. It might be cold, but that was because fires were not usually lit in this part of the house. There might be an odd, sour smell in the air, but that was nothing that a good airing wouldn't soon fix. And it might feel a little strange and old, but that was no surprise, as this part of the house had been built well over 300 years ago. A small light glinting a little way along the passage made her stop short for a moment, her heart thumping.
but no sooner had she halted than she realized it was just the reflection of her own candle in an old looking glass. She shook her head at herself. She was being jumpy and silly. "There's no such thing as ghosts," she muttered as she went on, feeling colder than ever as the wind howled louder outside. Halfway along the corridor, she glimpsed something lying on the floor, and she realized it was Lizzie's duster. She reached down to pick it up, and as she did so, she felt a sudden rush of air that made her skin bristle. It was ice cold. "Nothing more than a window left open somewhere," she thought. But then she heard something else. It was a sound, quite loud and unmistakable in this empty, dark, creaking part of the house. The hollow, echoing pad of footsteps. Footsteps that were moving slowly but purposefully towards her along the corridor, growing louder and louder all the time. It was a trick. It had to be.
"Charlie, I know it's you," she called out. "Come out and stop playing the fool."
But there was no reply, no answering snigger. Instead, the footsteps just kept coming towards her along the passageway, slow and heavy. Too heavy to be the steps of a young underfootman. Her chest tightened.
"If this is your idea of a stupid joke," she began,
but the words seemed to choke her and fell away. As she stared, she saw to her horror that a dark shape was moving steadily towards her. A tall, billowing, unearthly shadow, stretched into the shape of a human figure, advancing closer and closer along the wall. A bitter cold wind swept over her. Every instinct was screaming at her to run, but she seemed to be frozen to the ground. The shadow stretched towards her, a long, thin, black shape like an arm, reaching, until it could almost touch her. Then the candle suddenly snuffed out, and in the icy darkness, Tilly screamed. Chapter 2. We shall be delighted to welcome our special guests to the first Sinclair's New Year's Eve ball. Mr. Sinclair's voice, clear and strong, with a hint of American twang, rang out across the press club room at Sinclair's, London's most famous department store. "I intend this new event to become a regular fixture of London's social calendar." It was a few days before Christmas, and outside, the London streets were very cold, the first flakes of snow beginning to fall from a heavy grey sky. Inside, the wood-panelled room was warm and brightly lit, and crowded with journalists, all of them listening intently to Mr. Sinclair. A thick cloud of cigar smoke hung above their heads, blending with the rich aroma of Sinclair's at Christmas. It was the warm smell of cinnamon and toffee and spiced oranges, the sharp metallic tang of tinsel and silver paper, and something else too, something more difficult to identify, the tingling scent of anticipation. From where he stood at the very back of the room, Billy Parker, the youngest Sinclair's office boy, could sense a buzz of excitement in the air. All around him, people busily scribbled down Mr. Sinclair's words in their notebooks, whilst at the front, several photographers with cameras and tripods were jostling for position, each hoping to get the perfect shot of the man himself. Of course, this scene was not exactly an unusual one. Ever since the news had first broken that New York millionaire Edward Sinclair would be coming to London to open the city's finest department store, he had instantly become the darling of the press. And really, Billy thought, it was little wonder. After all, Mr. Sinclair always seemed to be planning some extraordinary new scheme, from ballet performances in the roof garden to a showing of one of the new moving pictures in the exhibition hall. He was frequently to be seen at London's most exclusive social gatherings, attending the first night of a fashionable new West End show, or dining at the best table in one of the city's finest restaurants. What was more, His department store was a place where sensational and dramatic things seemed to happen. Already, Sinclair's had seen everything from the daring robbery of precious jewels and priceless paintings to, it was rumored, a narrow escape from a bomb concealed in the store's famous golden clock. In less than a year, Mr. Sinclair had given the press a great deal to write about. But it wasn't only the journalists who were endlessly fascinated by the debonair department store owner, Billy reflected, as he craned his neck to try to catch a glimpse of the elegant figure, immaculate as always, right down to the perfect orchid in his buttonhole. They might have been working him for many months, but Mr. Sinclair's own staff still speculated about their employer just as much as ever. Although he could be seen at the store almost every day, although his photograph appeared most weeks in the society pages of the illustrated papers, Billy thought now that there was still an awful lot that they did not know about the man they called the Captain. "Of course, as you know, gentlemen, I do beg your pardon, ma'am, gentlemen and ladies," Mr. Sinclair was saying, with a courtly bow in the direction of the single female journalist in the room, "as you know, we don't do things in any ordinary, commonplace way here at Sinclair's. So you may be sure that this will be no ordinary or commonplace entertainment. We shall be welcoming in 1910 in truly spectacular style. Is that not so, Monsieur Chevalier?" He turned to the man standing beside him, a smartly dressed gentleman with a pointed black beard. "Indeed we will," said the gentleman, speaking with a strong French accent. "I am honored, most honored, to be launching my new scent, Midnight Peacock, at the wonderful Sinclair's. What finer setting for a fête unlike anything we have seen before. Incroyable et inoubliable." There was a murmur of appreciation from the journalists as Mr. Sinclair went on. "Decorations, costumes, and entertainments for the ball have been specially designed for the occasion by Monsieur Chevalier himself, taking inspiration from Midnight Peacock. Helping him to create the spectacle are artist Mr. Max Kamensky and the West End's renowned duo, Mr. Lloyd and Mr. Mountville, who are producing a special entertainment for the evening." "I say, they really are going to be putting on a show," Billy heard one journalist whisper to another amongst a frenzy of excited scribbling. "Our guests for the evening will enjoy refreshments from the Marble Court restaurant, courtesy of our celebrated chef, Monsieur Bernard. A showcase of Maison Chevalier's latest styles featuring our famous mannequins. And of course, the opportunity to be amongst the first to sample this magnificent new perfume," Mr. Sinclair continued. "What is more, although the ball itself will be for invited guests, the festivities will spread out on to Piccadilly, and I hereby extend a cordial invitation to members of the public to gather and share in the countdown to midnight. With the support of our neighbors, we have arranged a special firework display from the rooftops of Piccadilly Circus, which will be a fitting conclusion to our evening of celebration."
"Good heavens!" the second journalist whispered back. "Fireworks as well? Sinclair doesn't do things by halves, does he? I'll wager he'll get such a crowd, the authorities will have to close off the street," said another. "What else do you suppose he's got up his sleeve?"
But at the front of the room, it was clear that Mr. Sinclair was bringing his address to a conclusion.
"I believe we have time for one or two questions," he said.
A forest of hands surged into the air. Mr. Sinclair singled out a young man with a curled moustache, who Billy recognized as a journalist for one of the fashion papers.
"Can you tell us more about what we can expect to see at the ball?"
he asked eagerly.
"Ah, we do not wish to give away too many of our secrets," said Monsieur Chevalier, his small dark eyes twinkling. "For that would spoil the surprise, would it not?"
A bluff, older man with grey hair was selected next.
"What do you make of Mr. Huntington's plans, announced just this afternoon, to hold a New Year's entertainment at his store?" he demanded. Do you see Huntington's New Year's tea dance as a rival to your ball?
I am sure Mr. Huntington's little party will be a most delightful affair, answered Mr. Sinclair, his voice as smooth as cream. Of course, our entertainment will be in a rather different league. A tea dance certainly isn't. There was a warm bubble of knowing laughter, and then it was the young lady journalist's turn to speak.
Is there truth to the rumor that His Majesty the King will be amongst your guests? She asked.
Mr. Sinclair gave her his most charming smile.
Now, of course, I couldn't possibly comment upon His Majesty's engagements, but what I will say is that we think this will certainly be a celebration worthy of royalty.
At these words, a murmur of excitement ran around the room, and more hands were thrust into the air, but Mr. Sinclair was already shaking his head.
No more questions, I'm afraid. If you require more details, please apply to my private secretary, Miss Atwood. But for now, I would like to cordially invite you to remain here in the press club room for a festive drink to thank you for your support of Sinclair's during our first year of business. And when you leave, do look out for our special midnight peacock window displays. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. And may I take this opportunity to wish you a Merry Christmas on behalf of all at Sinclair's.
As the members of the press accepted glasses of sherry from waiters with silver trays, two floors above them, Sophie Taylor was sitting in the window, watching the dizzy, dancing swirl of snowflakes fall on the street outside. The clock on the mantelpiece had just chimed 4 o'clock, and the light was already fading. But down below her, all along the street, the shop windows were bright and twinkling, and the pavements were thronged with people, wrapped up in overcoats and mufflers. Groups were gathering before the windows of Sinclair's to admire the parade of Christmas trees, beautifully dressed with gleaming silver stars, candied apples, and bonbons wrapped in shiny paper. Another cluster of people were exclaiming over the window dressed all in purple and gold, which advertised Maison Chevalier's forthcoming Midnight Peacock perfume. Beyond, uniformed porters hurried out to waiting motorcars and taxicabs, their arms piled high with Sinclair's parcels. And all the while, Sidney Parker, the head doorman, stood at the top of the steps ringing a bell to welcome people in. Through the great doors and into the store, the entrance hall was crowded with shoppers. Even during the grand opening earlier that year, Sophie did not think that Sinclair's had ever been as bright and busy as it was now. Of course, everyone in London wanted to buy their gifts at Sinclair's, and at that very moment, Sophie knew that gentlemen were purchasing pocket handkerchiefs for their young ladies, mamas and papas were selecting train sets and teddy bears, and ladies of fashion were choosing fans and gloves for their dearest companions. The confectionery department would be the busiest of all, crowded with people buying sugar-dusted Turkish delight, silver cones of rose and violet creams, and box after box of glorious Sinclair's chocolates, nestled amongst feather-light layers of snow-white tissue and tied with a blue satin bow. Sophie had a box of the chocolates beside her on the desk at that very moment. The confectioners had been experimenting with a new festive recipe, and Billy had brought up some samples for them to try. Now, she popped one into her mouth, tasting the melting sweetness of caramel and chocolate as she gazed out at the falling snow and the shoppers surging in and out of the store. As she watched, she saw the figure of a tall gentleman with a military bearing. For one heart-stopping moment, she thought that she recognized him. Then that sense of familiarity vanished as quickly as it had come, and he was just a stranger again. A little girl was clinging to his hand, obviously nervous of the crowds. His daughter, she supposed. As she watched, he paused and bent down to comfort her. She turned abruptly away from the window. She had done quite enough daydreaming for one day, she told herself sternly, trying to fix her attention on the document that lay before her on her desk. But even as she began to read, the typed heading, Case Notes, blurred before her eyes, and she found herself reaching up to trace the thin, curving line of the white scar that ran across one side of her forehead. The scar was barely visible, but for Sophie, it was important. It was a sign, perhaps the only sign, of everything that had happened to her in the past year. There was nothing else to show that she was different. She hadn't grown as much as an inch in the last 12 months, and as for her long, fair hair, however much time she spent arranging it, it still had exactly the same annoying habit of slipping down. Her clothes, perhaps, were nicer than they had been, and here she stroked the skirt of her well-cut frock with satisfaction. Mrs. Sinclair liked them to wear the very latest styles, and had given both her and Lil a generous dress allowance to spend in the ladies' fashions department. They both enjoyed choosing new frocks, but whilst Lil liked ornamenting her outfits with all the most fashionable accessories, dramatic fringed scarves, beaded chokers and pendant necklaces, Sophie always found herself coming back to the same old string of green beads that had once belonged to her mama. She was wearing them today, and now she let the cool shapes of the beads run through her fingers. Sophie had never known her mother, who had died when Sophie was very small, but she had thought about her a good deal in the past few months. She felt full of questions about her, but there was no one left to answer them now. Could it really have been only a year that she had first heard the news that Papa had died? Since then, her life had been turned upside down. She had gone from having a father and a home at Orchard House to being all alone in the world, and then she had found a new place for herself at Sinclair's. Somehow, she had found friends and a job that, unexpectedly, she had turned out to be rather good at. For a moment, she grinned to herself. 12 months ago, she could certainly never have imagined that she was about to begin a career as a detective. But the smile was only a fleeting one. For thinking of that only made her recall all the other things that had happened in the past year, and especially her encounters with the villain called the Baron. Last Christmas, she had never even heard that name. But since then, she and her friends had crossed the path of London's most notorious crime lord on several occasions. Between them, they had managed to prevent his scheme to destroy Sinclair's with an infernal machine, even after being locked up in the summer house in the roof garden by one of his henchmen. They'd exposed his disguise as the aristocrat Lord Bowcastle, and helped to liberate much of London's East End from the stranglehold of his vicious gang, the Baron's Boys. Most recently of all, they had rescued 2 valuable paintings by the Italian artist Benedetto Caselli, which the Baron had stolen on behalf of a secret society known as the Fraternitas Draconum, or the Brotherhood of Dragons. Though the society itself remained a mystery, it was thanks to their efforts that several of the Baron's accomplices were now in jail, and that the Baron himself was a wanted man, on the run from Scotland Yard. He hadn't been seen by anyone since she had come face to face with him in a darkened Chelsea alleyway some months ago. Of all their encounters, it was that one that she thought of most. Perhaps that was because it had been the first time that she had faced the Baron alone, or perhaps because he had confessed to her that he had killed not only her beloved papa, but her mother too, many years earlier. She had escaped from the encounter with no more than the scar on her forehead. Now, in spite of the warm fire, she shivered, thinking how lucky she had been. "I could have killed you 12 times, he had told her. The words still puzzled her. It was true, so why hadn't he? The Baron had a reputation for ruthlessness, for exacting the most horrible revenge on anyone who crossed him. Yet he had let her go, saying only, "Farewell. This time I know I'll see you again." She found she was tapping her pen irritably against the desk. When it came to the Baron, there were always these questions. The same frustrating spiral of mysteries and riddles. She counted them off the ever-growing list. How had the Baron known her parents? He had told her that he had once been a friend of her papa's, but how could she possibly square the memory of her kind-hearted father with what she knew of the Baron's cruelty and greed? She knew her papa had travelled during his military career, so perhaps the Baron had crossed his path. But how could he have met her mamma? She heard the whisper of the Baron's voice again. When she was by my side, she was the toast of Cairo. She gave all that up for a home and a husband. And you. Cairo? What on earth had her mother been doing in Egypt? She knew nothing of either of her parents ever having travelled there. Ought she even to believe a single word that the Baron had said? She got up from her chair and walked over to the fire. She'd promised herself that she would stop going round in circles like this. She'd spent weeks after her last encounter with the Baron, mulling over everything he had told her, trying to piece together each tiny bit of evidence. It had been their friend and advisor, Mr. McDermott, himself a private detective, who had put a stop to that.
"I'd advise you to leave it alone. The Baron is the only one who can answer those questions, and with Detective Worth and Scotland Yard top men on his trail, he would be foolish to set so much as a foot in this country. Try to forget about him, and focus your attention on Taylor and Rose."
Mr. McDermott had been right, of course. He usually was. Reluctantly, she'd taken down the photograph of the Baron and her parents from the wall and filed it away in the folder in their office that was neatly labelled The Baron. For that was what she was going to do with the Baron now, she told herself. File him away with the rest of their paperwork on the office shelves. Far better to put all that aside and keep her attention firmly fixed upon new mysteries. They certainly had plenty of those to keep them busy. In their first 2 months of business, Taylor and Rose had dealt with half a dozen different cases, from missing jewels to strange anonymous letters. Thanks to Mr. Sinclair's appetite for publicity, everyone knew about his latest innovation, London's first, and only, young ladies' detective agency. From where she stood beside the fire, Sophie could see its name, Taylor and Rose, printed in curving gold script across the glass panel of their office door. Plenty of people had already come through that door, curious to see Mr. Sinclair's young lady detectives for themselves. At first, the stream of visitors had made Sophie nervous. She lay awake at night, wondering how they could show everyone that two young girls really were capable of being detectives. But little by little, she found her confidence was growing. With Mr. McDermott's guidance, Taylor and Rose was beginning to thrive, and Sophie had suddenly found herself a person of some consequence at Sinclair's. When she had been a shop girl, she had been all but invisible, passing unnoticed through the crowds of shoppers. Now, people turned to look at her. Salesgirls stared curiously in her direction. Customers nudged each other, recognizing her photograph in the newspapers, and some of the older doormen shook their heads, muttering that they didn't know what the world was coming to. It would seem that not everyone approved of the idea of a young lady becoming a private detective. But Sophie paid that no attention. She loved being part of Taylor and Rose. She had never really felt like she fitted in with Edith and the other salesgirls in the millinery department. It was not that she minded selling hats for a living. In fact, there had been times when she had rather liked it. But her new work fascinated her like nothing else. Of course, the cases they dealt with were not on the same scale as the Baron's schemes, but each was engrossing just the same. They put her brain to the test, forcing her to trust her instincts and hone her powers of observation. And they absorbed her completely. But today, for once, she was struggling to keep her mind on work. It was almost Christmas, and the office of Taylor and Rose was unusually quiet. Mr. McDermott was away on the continent on business, Lil had gone out to visit one of their clients, and whilst the rest of Sinclair's hummed with people on the first floor, Sophie had been alone all the afternoon. The office was a pleasant place, attractively decorated for them on Mr. Sinclair's orders, with a pretty sitting area, furnished with elegant chairs and a table spread with the latest fashion papers. There were two desks, one for Sophie and one for Lil, and even the telephone which Mr. Sinclair had insisted must be installed stood on its own dainty little table beside a vase of flowers. Yet in spite of Mr. Sinclair's ladylike vision, the office of Taylor and Rose had swiftly acquired its own particular atmosphere, which was not really smart or elegant at all. It was a place where friends came to call, where crumpets were toasted before the fire on wet afternoons, where tea was poured from their own teapot, books and newspapers were read, and the latest cases were discussed. Sophie, usually pacing up and down the rug, whilst Lil leaned back in her chair, resting her boots on her desk in a most unladylike manner. In fact, the office had begun to feel like home, Sophie thought, in a way that nowhere had since she had left Orchard House a year ago. But thinking of Orchard House led her back to Papa, and thinking of Papa led her back to the Baron, and that was no good at all. Sophie went back over to the desk, curled herself in her chair, and pulled the sheaf of documents decisively towards her. She must stop thinking about all that, and actually do something useful. "Case notes," she read. But before she had got any further, there came an unexpected knock on the office door. Chapter 3.
"It's only me," said a familiar voice, and Billy came into the room bearing a stack of envelopes. "We finished downstairs. Mr. Sinclair, the journalist, eaten out of the palm of his hand, of course. They're ever so excited about the New Year's Eve ball. Here, I brought up your post."
Before he handed it over, he paused for a moment to shake his head at Sophie. Billy was always very keen to ensure that Taylor and Rose operated as professionally as possible. Though he continued to work in Mr. Sinclair's offices, reporting to Miss Atwood, he had been given permission to spend one day a week helping Sophie and Lil with their new business. And that was a jolly good job, he was given to remark, since neither of them had the first idea of how an office ought to be run.
"If you want Mr. Sinclair to take you seriously, then you have to do things properly," he reprimanded Lil half a dozen times a day.
Billy had been well trained by Miss Atwood, and in his books, doing things properly meant writing reports, filing documents, keeping careful accounts with neat red lines ruled in all the right places, and making sure their desks were always tidy. That was an easy enough matter for Sophie, who rather liked putting things in order, but an almost impossible task for Lil, who was forever surrounded by a jumble of crumpled papers and spilled ink. "Most importantly of all," Billy said, "they must always be ready to receive clients who might turn up without an appointment." Now he looked at Sophie disapprovingly. Sitting comfortably curled up in a chair was not what he considered properly businesslike. But Sophie just grinned at him. "I don't think we'll get any new clients this afternoon," she said. "They're all downstairs, choosing presents and buying delicious things to eat. Christmas just isn't the season for mysteries. Why don't you sit down? I'm sure Miss Atwood can spare you for a few minutes, and I was just going to make some tea." Appreciating the logic of this, Billy shrugged and flopped down into a chair.
"Oh, are those the notes from the Albemarle case?" he asked with interest. "Let's have a look."
Sophie passed over the documents willingly as she flicked quickly through the afternoon post. At first glance, it all looked quite usual. Two letters from clients that she put aside to read later, some bills and circulars, and the latest edition of theatrical news for Lil, who combined working for Taylor and Rose with performing on the West End stage. But underneath them was a narrow envelope with a foreign stamp. She frowned. Surely that handwriting was familiar. She swiftly ripped the envelope open, but a gasp of surprise was stifled by the bang of the door opening again as Lil burst into the room, her cheeks rosy from the cold.
"Hello, all,"
she announced breathlessly, casting off a stylish coat with a fur collar, and tossing a pair of new kid gloves carelessly down upon the chair. Whilst she might look very much the glamorous young actress these days, Sophie knew that underneath the fashionable clothes and hairstyles, Lil was just the same girl that she had been when they had met at Sinclair's for the very first time. There could certainly be no doubt that she still talked just as much as ever, Sophie thought with a smile.
"Gosh, I don't think I've ever seen the store so busy before, have you?" "Oh, yes, it all went quite well. Miss Balfour said she was awfully pleased with everything we've done, and she's going to recommend Taylor and Rose to all her friends. I say, just look at how the snow is coming down. It makes me feel like it's really Christmas. Isn't it cosy in here?
Joe's on his way up, and look, Leo's come to tea with us. I've promised her cake, so I jolly well hope we've got some. Sophie saw that another girl, of about the same age, had followed Lil into the room. In her plain, dark coat, now speckled with melting snowflakes, Leo Fitzgerald could easily have been mistaken for any ordinary schoolgirl. But the big portfolio she carried, and a certain dreamy gleam in her brown eyes, were clues to the fact that Leo was a promising young artist, currently studying at London's prestigious Spencer Institute.
"Hello, Leo!" exclaimed Billy.
"Come and sit by the fire and get warm. It's so cold outside," Sophie urged her. "I didn't realise you were still in London. I thought you'd have already gone home for the Christmas holidays." Leo carefully set down her portfolio and the cane she always used, a rather beautiful one, made from a rich, dark wood with a handle carved into the shape of a lion's head. "I'm going tomorrow," she explained as she unwound her scarf. "Some of us students have been helping Mr. Kaminsky with the scenery for the New Year's Eve ball, and there's been an awful lot to do, but it's been good fun, and truthfully, I've been rather glad to have an excuse to stay in town."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.